This is the Film Geeks Podcast.
1, 2, 3. Casey Affleck finally emerges out of his brother's shadow and Moonlight leaves La La Land in the dust with a little help from Bonnie and Clyde. However, it was not all dark for La La Land as Emma Stone rose above Meryl Streep to win Best Actress and Damien Chazelle became the youngest ever to win the Best Director's Award. And speaking of new direction, is the DC Cinematic Universe heading towards a brand new one as a new franchise may be on the horizon? Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to yet another edition of the Film Geeks Podcast, powered by the Indian Nerve, and we have a great show lined up for all of you people out there. Joining me, as always, are Arindam, Anir, and we have a very special guest on this edition of the Film Geeks Podcast, Indian Nerve's own, Aditya. Welcome to the show, Aditya. This is your second time here.
I appreciate the good introduction. No, I was saying, I guess now I kind of know what it feels like when Brock Lesnar is introduced by Paul Heyman.
Joining me, as always, the A-team, Anirban and Arindam. So, how are you guys doing today?
Much better than Warren Beatty.
I finally found a house, so I'm doing much better.
This has been like a huge journey for you, man. I mean, literally and figuratively. You've been looking for a house for how long now? I mean, every time we record, we speak with you, and you are like, dude, I'm so tired. I'm just looking for a house. Yeah, I'm not getting a house, man. So when did you get the house?
We got it yesterday, man. We got it yesterday. We finalized the place. We met the owner. We paid the token up front, and everything is good. It's a beautiful house, and when you guys visit, it's a fully furnished house. So yeah, we can party, man.
Anyone remembers a horror movie in which the toilet water is black? Yeah, because that just happened. With me.
Are you living in Bombay?
Yeah. I think they did some toilet cleaning. Yeah, that's... the overhead water cleaning and everything. So I think that's the reason why.
Although I did read this really unsettling article once about that thing happening in a hotel, like the toilet water and the water in the faucet turned black. And then it turned out there had been a body decomposing
dead
in the overhead tank.
Luckily for me, it wasn't the drinking water this time.
So keeping up with this very grim tone, I know it may come across as something which is really funny or humorous, but trust me, we have nothing but respect for this man. Bill Paxton, the actor behind iconic roles in Aliens, Titanic, and Apollo 13, has passed away. He was 61 years old, and according to TMZ, who first reported this news, Bill Paxton died after complications from his surgery. The 61-year-old actor had a string of hits with films like Aliens, like I mentioned, and Twister, and was more recently seen in Marvel's Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. He also has a role in the upcoming film starring Emma Watson and Tom Hanks, the Silicon Valley thriller, The Circle. Bill Paxton, man, 2017, it's not going to get any much better, I don't think.
Bill Paxton was one of those actors, like, no matter the role, however small, he always made an impression on you. Like, I remember stepping out of Edge of Tomorrow, and the first thing that stuck to my mind was like, oh, holy shit, that was such a great Bill Paxton role. It wasn't Emily Blunt, it wasn't Tom Cruise. The first thing that came to my mind was, holy shit, how good was Bill Paxton in his role. So he always made it point to, no matter how small the role, he made a lasting impression on you. And he was one of those great character actors whom you saw, but sometimes you never knew who that guy was. And also, apart from Lance Henriksen, he was one of the few people on Earth, maybe among the only two on Earth who got killed by an alien, a predator, and a Terminator.
Yeah, I completely agree what Arindam just said. Even if you didn't really know who he was, it kind of made a lasting impression on you. In fact, when I read that Bill Paxton had died, like, it really hit me. But then later when I was thinking about it more deeply, I didn't really understand why it hit me. Because if I try to list down 10 Bill Paxton movies, I kind of have to, like, look at Wikipedia or IMDb to do that. But then, like, I saw some really key names in that list. You know, like, for me, actually, when I think of Bill Paxton, I think of Twister. Because I think that Twister came out at an age when I was just getting into movies. I remember it used to be played on HBO all the time. I remember seeing that Twister at an age when I was, like, really impressionable, and it was probably one of the first English language movies that I watched, like, on TV, and that's when I really started getting into the English movies at that age. So I think that's why that left, like, a strong impression on me, and he left a strong impression on me, and plus, as you mentioned, he's been in some really iconic movies, like Terminator, Aliens, True Lies also. So even though he was, like, in pretty small roles in a couple of those films, it really leaves, like, a lasting impression. So yeah, definitely he's going to be missed.
I think I actually agree with what Arindam said about him being a great character actor. You have this lot of roles where you sort of won't realize that it's him, but they're so iconic. I mean, my first and only impression of Bill Paxton is his character from True Lies, where he's that really, really pervy character that leaves that sort of disgust in your stomach. I don't know why, but every time I looked at him, I saw Bill Paxton, I'm reminded of that movie. And that's what you want, right? Role that is so iconic that you associate it with that person, and he sort of becomes that character. And that's what is so great about this guy, is that he's been part of so many movies, and you'll not remember him as Bill Paxton, the actor. You'll remember him for the roles that he did, and which is why I'm really, really sad that he has passed away. I'm sure that he'll be missed.
When you talk about Bill Paxton, such a great character actor, I think when you think about his films, like Aditya mentioned, like he doesn't have a lot many roles where he stands out as the star of a film. Like there is no particular film that you associate with his name like we do with say, for example, J.K. Simmons, who is one of the great character actors of this day and age. You associate Whiplash with him, or to some extent, you even associate Spider-Man with him. But with Bill Paxton, I think you have to dig deep, because he was that guy in that film, right? And it's only after now that he's gone, and he's not been in the public eye for a while, at least not in the mainstream for a while. I think now you can appreciate what a great actor this guy was, especially in the 90s and in the 80s, where you had so many great character actors, and this guy stood head and shoulders above a lot of different actors. I think one of his roles which really stuck with me, and this movie is one of my favorite movies of all time, and he is probably my favorite character in an Arnold Schwarzenegger movie. It's a very difficult thing to do. And his role as a salesman posing to be a spy, trying to seduce Jamie Lee Curtis in True Lies, that is one of my favorite comedic roles of the 90s. I mean, that movie had Tom Arnold, that movie had Arnold Schwarzenegger at the height of his powers, but Bill Paxton in that film was something else. He just had a cameo. It probably was just a 15, 20 minute role, but the amount of swag he brings to that role, the amount of even depth and the comedic timing that he has, and the amount that he makes your skin crawl by the pervert that he portrays, that is something that is the hallmark of an amazing actor. And secondly, I like Arindam also mentioned, one of his last few great roles was his role as the sergeant in Edge of Tomorrow. You just don't even realize he's there, because he's just so perfect, right? I mean, you just now if I look back at that movie and I think about an alternate casting, like sometimes we do, I can't think of any other person who could play that role apart from Bill Paxton. So Aditya, let's start with you. What are your favorite Bill Paxton movies?
So like I mentioned, for me, the first one that comes to mind is Twister, because that's the one that before I knew Bill Paxton was, that movie really imprinted its face in my mind. And then over the years, as I watched like Terminator, for example, I realized that he has, like, again, a really small role in that, right? But somehow I just remember who that guy was in that movie. Like when I read that Bill Paxton was in Terminator, like it instantly pops into my head. And as you mentioned, True Lies, again, that was one of my favorite movies as well when I was growing up. And I completely echo what you said. Like when I think back on that movie now, of course, you remember Arnold Schwarzenegger because he's like this massive movie star. But if I remember one other thing from that movie, it's that guy's character. And it just really creates an indelible impression on the short amount of time that he's on screen. So those are the three movies that I think of when I think of Bill Paxton. I think of True Lies, I think of Terminator, and I think of Twister, of course. I haven't seen Edge of Tomorrow yet.
What? How have you not watched Edge of Tomorrow?
There are a ton of movies that I haven't watched that I should have watched. I haven't even watched Titanic, and that's new to Titanic, right? Yeah, let's not get into the list of movies that I haven't watched. I'll probably boot it out of this podcast.
Arindam, what are your favorite Bill Paxton roles?
We always mention him as an actor, but he was also a pretty great director. One of his directorial debut, in fact, was a movie called Frailty. It's a supernatural version of Usual Suspects, because that is the closest thing that I can think of. It had Matthew McConaughey playing his son, and Bill Paxton, he cast himself as the role of this father who, you know, he was blessed by an angel to seek out the demons who had assumed human form, and he used to hunt them down.
but the entire movie keeps you guessing if they are delusional and he's just a psychotic serial killer, or is it actually like the hand of God who's doing it. So it's a very neat movie, and it has an awesome twist at the end as well. And also there's another movie by Catherine Bigelow. It was one of the first movies that she had done. It's called Near Dark. It's one of the best vampire movies that you're going to see. And you can never call a vampire movie realistic depiction, but it is as real and as gritty as it gets. It also starred Adrian Pasdar. He's this vampire who's just this normal dude who gets bitten by a vampire, and he gets converted, of course. And then he has to be initiated into this gang. And this gang also has Bill Paxton, this amazing role called Severin. You say that, you know, he was creepy in True Lies. You should see this movie and you should see how he played out Severin. That was like creepiness to the max. It also had Lance Henriksen as the leader of those vampires. So those are two movies which are very underrated, and you should definitely go check it out. It's Frailty and it's Near Dark.
I remember Terminator Genisys. There was the entire opening sequence was recreated from the original Terminator film. And what got me really excited about that entire sequence is as the first appearance of Arnold Schwarzenegger in the original Terminator, the first one, was him meeting Bill Paxton's character. And I was really excited when I watched this because I thought Bill Paxton is going to make an appearance, a young Bill Paxton digitally recreated is going to make an appearance. And I was really disappointed that he was not there. So this was my last, actually probably one of the last times I've actually thought about him at a movie theater. But moving on, that was just my simple random thought about this entire issue. Anirban, why don't you tell us about your favorite Bill Paxton roles?
Yeah, so the first one for me is True Lies. I always associate Bill Paxton with True Lies. That shady, creepy character is Bill Paxton for all purposes. I cannot think of any other person who could have played that role. He was and probably will always be perfect for that role. Second movie that I can think about is Nightcrawler. Nightcrawler, I found this role to be really apt as the station chief. And as we have already discussed, you know, he fits into this role where you don't notice him at first. But then when you do, you always tend to associate Bill Paxton's character with him and not really Bill Paxton the actor. The third thing that I'm role that he did was not a movie per se. It was the TV series Big Love. So it was based on a functional Mormon family that practiced polygamy, and it also starred Jennifer Goodwin and Chloe Sevigny and Jean Triplehorn. That was a fantastic role. I think it also got a lot of good reviews and was widely popular when it was aired. Yeah, these are the three roles that I most remember Bill Paxton for.
From bittersweet memories of Bill Paxton to something which promises at least for us hardcore comic book fans, believe it or not, we still are DC fans. We have a lot of hopes for this DC cinematic universe. And one good news which has come out this week is Chris McKay, the guy who directed the greatest Batman film of all time, the Lego Batman movie, is plotting a new DC superhero film based on the Batman-centric character, Nightwing. That's right, the Lego Batman movie director Chris McKay is in negotiations to helm the new live-action film, and Bill Dubuque, the guy who wrote The Accountant, is writing the script as well. No actor has been cast in this role yet. All we know is Chris McKay is attached to this project, and that gets me, at least, really, really, really excited. We're not going to get into storylines, but really quickly, before we go on to our Oscar discussion, guys, tell me, who would you rather cast as Nightwing? Let's start with you, Arindam.
I would cast Milo Ventimiglia, the guy who was Peter Petrelli from Heroes. He looks the part, he can act. He has shown us from this new show called This Is Us, which you guys should be watching, that he can do drama really well. And he looks the part, and I'm pretty sure he's, if he gets trained, I think he'll kick ass as Dick Grayson.
I think that's a good one. So what I was thinking of is, we spoke about Nightcrawler earlier. I've always been a huge fan of Jake Gyllenhaal, especially if we're like in a universe where, say, Jason Todd is already there. Like, if they want to go for a slightly older Dick Grayson, I think Jake Gyllenhaal would be an awesome choice. But if they want to go with someone younger, I was reading that one of the guys in contention or would be more for the role is Ben Barnes. who played the role of the William's coffee friend in Westworld. I forget his name. So those are the two names that I have in mind.
Yeah, just bear with me on this one. Garrett Hedlund. His first few roles were, you know, those teenage love boy movies. And then when Tron came out, I was seriously impressed with that guy. Unfortunately, I haven't seen him around too much. And he doesn't fit into the whole thing, Nightwing, immediately. He doesn't strike you immediately as the perfect casting. But when you think about it, he has got a build for it. He has got the acting chops for it. And I think he's pretty athletic enough to pull it off.
That's actually very measured casting choices. In fact, all of them, especially Arindam's one, this one has been doing the fan casting rounds for a while. I mean, everyone wants Milo Ventimiglia to be Nightwing. It has been talked about since Heroes came out. But if you ask me, we are at a timeline in the DC movies where Batman is kind of old. So I think the guy who fits the mold perfectly is Jared Padalecki. And that would be my choice. Jared Padalecki, if you are not familiar with his roles, he plays Sam Winchester in Supernatural. As if you are a fan of Supernatural, you know he's a very good actor. He is good as Sam. He can do action. And he doesn't need to be spry, because this is a Nightwing who doesn't necessarily have to be a gymnast like he is supposed to be in the comic books. He can be someone who is a much more spry version of Batman, perhaps. And that is my exact reason why you can cast Jared Padalecki as Nightwing. And he has, in fact, come out and said that he wants to play this character. And just bear with me here. For Jason Todd, I think the perfect casting would be taking his animated counterpart and casting him in real life. And that is cast Jensen Ackles himself as Jason Todd in the live action film, because we know that this guy has the acting chops. He has the voice. In fact, he was the first one to be considered for Captain America and he didn't take up the role. And I think if this role is offered to him, I don't think he's going to refuse it this time.
Let me just quickly blow your mind right now. In the DCEU, who is Thomas Wayne?
Yeah, I know.
So you're just doing Supernatural fan casting, so that doesn't count. Okay, I have one quick thought. Just see how this pans out. What if we have Chris O'Donnell come back and redeem himself?
Wow.
As Nightwing.
He's too fat for this, man. He's too fat.
They can always train, man. They can always train.
I can't even remember. Imagine Chris Donnell movie.
I think at this time, Chris O'Donnell is older than Ben Affleck and Henry Cavill combined.
I like that.
If you would have asked me, I had my serious doubts with Ben Affleck as Batman as well. He was not a very good Daredevil, and I was not really sure if he could pull the action bits off as well. It can always work. With the help of a good script and a good director, it can always work. But then again, we're talking about DC here, who really don't have a very good track record. They just got pasted in the Razzies as well. I mean, the biggest movie till now just got like, I don't know, four of the big awards. They really need a good film coming out right now. And they have Chris McKay. All they need to do is nail the casting. And probably we can have our first clear-cut good DC film, because the jury is still out on Wonder Woman. And not a lot of good news is coming out of the Justice League camp and the Batman camp as well.
Remind me whether DC or Marvel has the Oscar right now.
I know you're trying to gain a lot of brownie points from all the DC fanboys who've been calling us, you know, who think that we are Marvel fanboys, but we are not. We love DC, all right? And DC is, among the both of them, DC has the first mover advantage. DCEU has won an Oscar. Marvel has not. So keeping up with this talk of the Oscars, let's go and talk about the Oscar. Now, let's go ahead and speak about the very first thing that we are going to be focusing on, and that is the Best Animated Feature. And the nominees were Kubo and the Two Strings, Moana, My Life as a Zucchini, The Red Turtle, and the winner, of course, was Zootopia. So I don't think anyone contends here that the winner should not have been Zootopia. I think everyone here loves Zootopia. And I personally loved Kubo and the Two Strings more, but yeah, Zootopia was more topical and keeping up with the times.
I am good with Zootopia. I think it's a fantastic movie. Is it fantastic enough to win the Oscars? I don't think so. I think Kubo and the Two Strings was definitely miles ahead. When you think about the Oscars, see, we've all known that, or at least we associate the Oscars with cinematic brilliance. And you know, that's what Kubo and the Two Strings is. And Zootopia, while it is a fantastic movie and it did a lot of money, and obviously it has it is a very good movie to take your children and watch it, but Kubo and the Two Strings is by far the better movie.
We just don't seem to take this movie Zootopia very strongly right now, because it came out quite early in the year, right? And it has been it's long forgotten, because I don't think many of us have watched it more than once. So I guess that is the reason why everyone thinks that maybe it wasn't that good of a movie, but it had an excellent message, and for what it was very entertaining. It had multiple levels, and every time I saw it twice. And every time you tend to discover something new in it, because every time I saw it twice, and both were like totally different watches, and I loved it even more during the second watch. No doubt Kubo and the Two Strings was a more technical film, it was way better, and I think it and the VFX nod was certainly well deserved. But I think Zootopia is a better movie. I loved Kubo and the Two Strings, but overall Zootopia was a better movie.
You know, I think you're right about that. I think if Zootopia had in fact released later in the year, I think it might even have had a shot at like a Best Picture nomination, just because of everything that was going on in the real world. Because it was topical even very early on in the year. But imagine if it had come out like after Trump's election, or even just before the announcement of the immigrant ban. That would be a really topical time for that movie to release.
Right, I think Warren Beatty would have said Zootopia, you'd never know, because it was that good. And I think even Up was, even Up had been nominated for the Best Picture, if I'm not mistaken. And it had won for the Best Animated.
The shortest title to ever be nominated for Best Picture.
Right.
So moving on to Best Cinematography, the nominees were Arrival, Lion, Moonlight, Silence, and obviously the winner, of course, was La La Land. And you can't discredit this or dispute this. La La Land is a movie which looks extremely beautiful. It is a very old school, it has a very old school feel. In fact, they even reference a movie from where most of the tone was taken from, and that was Rebel Without a Cause. And there is an entire sequence where both the protagonists go and watch this movie in a theater, and it's an extremely well lit film. It's an extremely well directed film. We'll more about that later. But I think it deserves this award. It was a way better looking movie than Arrival, or even Moonlight, or even Silence for that matter. And Silence, of course, Martin Scorsese. I don't think anyone can dispute La La Land winning this award.
I'm going to dispute that, and it's not because La La Land is a bad movie. And I've made my views on musicals very clear from the beginning. I despise musicals. Everybody who knows me knows that I despise musicals. I watched it. I don't know, you got to treat me for this, man. I watched it. And I watched it with the intent of liking it, not disliking it. You know, things go, I went in with an open mind. And it's a good movie. I'll give you that. It's a great movie. But does it deserve the award for Best Cinematography? I don't think it has that over Silence. I don't think so. Silence was just too beautiful to watch. I mean, it didn't have all its components in the right place. But as far as cinematography goes, I think Silence was the better movie.
Just the last 10 minutes of La La Land, I think just because of the way it was shot, and the color schemes that were used, and the way the scenes were lit as it moved from one set piece to another, and the entire movie flowed in the last 10 minutes. Just for that, in my opinion, this movie deserved this award.
It had a ton of long shots, and if you had noticed, they were close sets. So every time they were going in and out of the frames, there was a change in light, and it was beautifully done. I think that was the reason, because of the long takes and how well it was adapted. Also during the song sequence, which is from which the poster is taken. It's a wonderfully lit shot. So I think that's the reason why it deserved it. It was like movie making at its best.
It was a very old school way, a very classic Hollywood 1950s, 1960s, even 1940s form of filmmaking, something which has been completely forgotten. And just because of that, I'm not a huge fan of the film. I mean, I don't hate on it, but I prefer the other movies like Moonlight or whatever. But this movie, actually, the way it was shot, it completely blew me away. And speaking about being blown away by performances, let's talk about the Best Supporting Actor. The nominees were Jeff Bridges for Hell or High Water, Lucas Hedges for Manchester by the Sea, Dev Patel for Lion, Michael Shannon for Nocturnal Animals, and the winner, of course, our boy, Mashallah Ali for Moonlight. What a performance. This was a powerhouse, all within 20 minutes.
No contest at all. That was like I had said, like yesterday, I think we were talking that what if this guy, he's in the role for barely 20 minutes? And what if he pulls off an Anthony Hopkins? So he just did that. That scene was so powerful when he explains what the term faggot means to the young black little, right?
Amazing scene. Yeah.
And he's just sitting there. I think that the 10 seconds in which he just sits and he bows his head is the reason why he got that Oscar. It was like so well done.
I don't think no one has bowed this well since Al Pacino in Godfather 2. You know, that was acting at its most powerful and its most emotional. I mean, this movie, right? I watched Manchester by the Sea and Moonlight on the same day. Moonlight just, it's still so, it has affected me so emotionally. Like, I just can't explain, I can just begin to explain how good of a movie Moonlight actually is.
I wouldn't have actually felt bad if Jeff Bridges would have won. I think Mahershala Ali actually deserved to win. I'm not contesting that at all. Don't get me wrong. But I don't think I would have felt bad if Jeff Bridges would have won. Equally deserving, because we talked about the recency effect, Zootopia with Zootopia, and movies that we have watched later tend to have a more lasting effect than movies that we have watched sometime ago. And Hello, High Water is something that came out earlier in the year, so I have already watched it when it came out. But I still remember Jeff Bridges' role in that movie. Although I'll say that I even liked Ben Foster in Hello, High Water, but then again, he wasn't nominated. But I watched Moonlight and I totally understand why he won. And I am not contesting it at all. I think that he deserves to win.
I'd like to disagree on Jeff Bridges even being nominated, actually, because I thought he was playing the same role he did from True Grit. He has that grizzled old man thing to him. And I think Ben Foster was the one who deserved the nomination, because that was totally against anything that I have ever seen him do. And I'd say that Ben Foster was a stronger actor in Hello, High Water. But those are just my two cents.
The best supporting actor performance that I've seen among the nominees this year actually wasn't even nominated. So I really loved Hugo Weaving's performance in Hacksaw. That was like amazing. It was beyond anything I've seen him do before.
I loved Hugo. It didn't even feel that he was acting like he was drunk. Like he was actually abusive and he was drunk. He was like that good.
He played the role of a drunk to perfection. And while I don't know whether he should have been nominated or not, but yeah, he did a very good job in that movie.
Yeah, I would like to disagree with both of you with regards to the nomination and the contention for Jeff Bridges. Yeah, I agree with Arindam when he says like Jeff Bridges is playing the same guy for which he won. I think he won an Oscar for True Grit as well. Did he win an Oscar for True Grit?
That was Crazy Heart.
Right. So he has been playing these grizzled old roles, right? He has been, it's just more or less the same guy that he played in Crazy Heart. He was just more unintelligible here. But I think one guy who deserved a nomination, I don't know if you guys would agree with this, and that's Ralph Ineson. He is, again, that guy in that film. So he plays Dagmar Clevejoy in Game of Thrones. Amicus Caro, he was Amicus Caro in the last three Harry Potter films, and he was Finchy from The Office, and this guy was amazing in The Witch, the father of Anya Taylor-Joy's character. I think that guy deserved to be nominated, and that's just my two cents. Probably he didn't get nominated because Witch came out at the starting of this year, and if it came out a little bit later in the October, November, probably when the Oscar season starts or is in full effect, I think Ralph Ineson deserved at least, and Witch in fact deserved one of the nods in one of the major categories. But that's just me. And moving on to Best Supporting Actress, Naomi Harris's turn in Moonlight got nominated. Nicole Kidman was amazing in Lion. Octavia Spencer was great in Hidden Figures. Michelle Williams had a star turn in Manchester by the Sea. But the winner, of course, a person whose snot has more acting talent than most actresses in Hollywood, Viola Davis for Fences.
I loved her role in Fences, but my problem with this award is that she was the lead actress in that movie. She didn't deserve to be in that category, and I think it was just I don't know why she was kept in that. Probably because they wanted Viola Davis to win, because she has been nominated for quite some time and this was her first win. So she is, definitely did not belong in that category. I think Michelle Williams deserved the award. No, I think this is the first.
I thought she won for The Help.
Yeah,
no, that was Octavia Spencer.
No, I don't have a problem with Viola Davis winning for Fences. As much as I loved Michelle Williams in Manchester by the Sea, I thought the only way I could describe her was so vulnerable yet incendiary. You know, I think she was there for like 10 minutes, but she was just amazing even before. When the movie starts and the last confrontation with Casey Affleck's character, I have never seen someone so vulnerable on screen, and this was just amazing. But Viola Davis was at a different league altogether, I thought. It was just an acting masterclass.
I'll agree with you on that one. I mean, it was a fantastic role, wasn't it? It was such a powerful role, man. There's no way that we... I don't think anybody should dispute the fact that she deserved to win. Maybe she could have even won for Best Actress. We'll come to that later. But I did love Michelle Williams' character in Manchester by the Sea. That last scene where she has a final confrontation with Casey Affleck is so strong, man. It's so strong that it just breaks your heart to watch that movie. I mean, this year, I think, has been sort of a bit different in the sense that we don't have too many movies that leave you feeling light and joyful. I think we had a lot of dark movies this year, and in that sense, I think Viola Davis's character in Fences definitely deserved to win.
I'm keeping with this theme of unending darkness. Let's speak about the best original screenplay. And I think we're going to have a little bit of a dispute here, because the nominees are Hell or High Water, a movie which all of us love, La La Land, a movie which some of us love, Lobster, a movie which people watched it love, and no one else, I think, in this panel, apart from, I think, Anirban, no one else has watched it. 20th Century Women, which I have not even heard of. And the winner, of course, was Manchester by the Sea. So best original screenplay. As much as I love Manchester by the Sea, Hell or High Water, man. What an unpretentious, unrelenting surge of vengeance. That's all I can say. It was just a white knuckle ride through an era which has forgotten to make a great Western film. And this was Hollywood reminding us that if they want to, they can still make great Western films. What did you guys think?
Yeah, I think I loved Hell or High Water as well as La La Land. But I think I would agree with the choice of the Academy in this case. I think Manchester by the Sea, the screenplay was so subtle, right? I mean, just the amount, considering the weight of the subject that they had to tackle, it could have been a very ripe feel for like melodrama, but just the subtlety with which everything was laid out and the pace with which everything was laid out. I don't have a disagreement with this. I think Manchester by the Sea would have been my choice as well.
Even I agree with the Academy's choice. I think Manchester by the Sea, it was very nuanced. It was an actor's screenplay through and through. I just loved everything. The dialogues are spot on. It was very natural, and I think it was very well deserved. Hell or High Water is, I loved it, but I think we have seen variations of the same thing in different movies. But Manchester by the Sea, it was totally original.
I think I will judge a movie by how much it tends to move me. And I think Manchester by the Sea is the second movie that has moved me as much as Taika Waititi's movie, which was called Boy, which was released in 2010. That movie and this movie sort of felt, at least in terms of how the emotions that it evoked in me, felt very similar in that sense. There was not a lot of story in there, but the way it's been structured, you can see that they have done a brilliant job. They have fit. Every scene is important in that in this movie, and it just has that very beautiful flow to it where you are not questioning the importance of any scene, which is what you want in a good screenplay, I believe. And so I think Manchester by the Sea definitely deserves the nod over Hell or High Water in that respect.
Yeah, and as Arindam mentioned, I think it was unexpectedly funny as well, right?
Right, I thought it would be a depression fest through and through. But then it was like, remember when he just, when the doctor says that he has that heart failure disease, And he says, what's a good disease? So, like, scenes like that, like, the humor came very naturally from the screenplay. And it was very well written. I'm certainly looking forward to what Ken Lonergan does next.
I think it was Ambarish who had watched this movie, the first from all among us, Ambarish from Indian, of course. And I think he put this idea in our head, at least in my head. I remember him talking about it or writing it somewhere that this movie was pretty sad. Now I understand why it's sad, but I thought, like Arindam mentioned, it was going to be a depression fest. But it was a lot lighter than I had expected. And moving on to our next category, and that is the best adapted screenplay. And the nominees were Arrival, Fences, Hidden Figures, Lion, and the winner, of course, is my favorite movie of last year, Moonlight. This Barry Jenkins, who adapted the screenplay based on In Moonlight, Black Boys Look Blue by Terrell Alvin McCraney. I have not read any of this or any of these original works on which these screenplays were based on, but I loved Moonlight. Among all of these nominees, be it Arrival, as much as we love Arrival, as much as we love Fences and Hidden Figures as well, I think Moonlight is the most poetic out of all of these. That's just how I feel about it. And just for the way it took a particular character and it took a particular setting and it presented it like Hollywood has never given these settings and these characters, just for the way, I'm not going to spoil it for all the people who are listening who might want to watch this movie, and I highly recommend that you do. I'm not going to spoil it for you. Just because of the way it treated the subject matter, just for that, I think this deserves all the awards that it has got and it will get in the near future. And speaking about awards and speaking about new winners and some old dogs in this category, let's talk about the best director. The nominees were Denis Villeneuve, Arrival, Mel Gibson for Hacksaw Ridge, coming out of nowhere, Kenneth Lonergan for Manchester by the Sea, Barry Jenkins for Moonlight, and obviously the winner, the youngest of them all, Damien Chazelle for La La Land.
I almost feel like disputing it because he's so young. Like, it just makes me question my purpose in life, that he's 32 years old.
And this is the second straight nomination, right?
Yeah.
Like, incredible, man. I can't wait to see Neil Armstrong, which ran
last. Oh, that's going to be amazing.
I like La La Land, but I thought Barry Jenkins and his treatment of that story in Moonlight, I thought that deserved the best director's award. But that's just me. I mean, as much as I love Damien Chazelle's work, as much as I like La La Land and the way, the entire movie was shot and the way the shots were created and all of that, as we spoke about in detail in the cinematography section as well, I think for that, yes, it deserves to be recognized, but Moonlight was something else, man. That was... I respect what Boyhood tried to achieve, but Moonlight for me stayed with me. You know, this is something I don't think I can relate with, but this is something which I have never, ever seen. I love a lot of urban movies, but this was something completely different and it completely stays with you. And that is why I felt Barry Jenkins should have won.
That's an interesting way to look at it. I'll sort of, there are two ways to look at it. One is the subject that we are talking about, and Moonlight, you have a lot of the story, the movie, depending on the actors and the way that they're going to portray their characters. But also you have to have a very good director who has to have the sense of where the story is going. And because a lot of this movie is not based on what the characters are saying per se, but also their actions, it becomes very important to sort of see the overall picture, and which is why you need a lot of vision, which I think Barry Jenkins definitely has. But when we talk about vision, I think Damien Chazelle definitely has a lot more vision in that respect, and La La Land definitely looks to be the more grand movie of the two. I will say I'll agree with you on the point that Moonlight definitely is the one that hits home and hits you where it matters, but La La Land definitely is the movie that has where you can definitely see the stamp of the director and his vision, which is why I think he probably got the award.
You just imagine the hard-on that Damien Chazelle has for jazz. He made two consecutive movies on how on his love for jazz and how important it is. And I really loved whatever he did. It was a complete unique vision. Like, just looking at any frame from the movie,
You just take it out and you can like obviously spot, yeah, this is La La Land. I loved how Moonlight was shot and how it looked, but I think from a directorial point of view, I think La La Land was certainly deserved it, and Damien Chazelle just like deserved it.
Let's move on to the next set of nominations, and we'll talk about the best actor. And the nominees were Andrew Garfield for Hacksaw Ridge, Ryan Gosling for La La Land, Viggo Mortensen for Captain Fantastic, Denzel Washington for Fences, and the winner, Casey Affleck for Manchester by the Sea. I thought there was no dispute in this. Casey Affleck was just fucking amazing in Manchester by the Sea. I mean, just the very few movies which captures grief the way Manchester by the Sea, and in particular Casey Affleck, does in this film. He is very sullen, very standoffish. He just doesn't want to engage with any other person. He was someone who was very personable when the movie started, and as the movie goes on, he becomes somewhat of a recluse, and the way his character goes through that development throughout the film was beautifully brought out by Casey Affleck. And it's a movie which we talk about of roles which portray actors coming of age. I think this movie is a microcosm of an actor coming to age, and that was Casey Affleck's performance in Manchester by the Sea.
No dispute whatsoever. It was just brilliant. I mean, exactly as you said, right? I mean, he had to portray this emotionally drained, empty, sullen, distant guy. And what's amazing is that he had, like, while doing that, he was still so compelling to watch, because it's very easy to sort of, you know, try and portray being emotionally distant and sort of come across as boring in the bargain, but that never happened with this character. Like, you always want to know more about him and why he became like that. So that was an amazing balance, which I think he sort of pulled off. And of course, that heartbreaking, heart-destroying police station scene, I'll never forget that.
Oh, yeah. That was depressing like hell. Like, when he just keeps on pressing the trigger, my God, that hits you. It's also funny that you mentioned that the portrayal of grief, because I just remember that there was another movie which came out this year, which I'm now that I think of it, I'm pretty surprised why Jake Gyllenhaal did not get nominated for Demolition, because Demolition was one of those movies that was as, like, I thought it was as good as Manchester by the Sea in its portrayal for grief, and Jake Gyllenhaal was amazing in that.
I think that movie is so hard to relate to that it sometimes throws people off. His portrayal might be spot on and all, but personally, when you think about grief and the way it works, at least thankfully we haven't gone through too much of that. But when you think about, when you watch the movie, you don't feel that kind of connect that you do with Casey Affleck and win Manchester by the Sea. You don't feel the same kind of connect, which is why I don't think he was even in contention. It was a great role, and it's a movie that went by unnoticed by most people. But at the same time, you can understand why that happened. And that's okay. And as far as, you know, we talked about Casey Affleck coming of age, I think he has done that a long time ago. It's just taken us a long time to realize what he is. I mean, Ben Affleck has always known that his brother is a very good actor and probably deserves a lot better roles than he gets. That's probably why he cast him as the protagonist in Gone Baby Gone, and which was a fantastic movie, and I love Casey Affleck's role in that. I think the movie that he did before that was the one with Brad Pitt, The Assassination of Jesse James. I mean, that was a lead role, but he didn't quite capture it right there. But in Gone Baby Gone, he absolutely gets it spot on. And you know, it's sad that people have only come to see his potential come to fruition now with Manchester by the Sea. And he's such a brilliant actor, and he probably deserves all the awards that he's getting for this movie.
I think it's very funny that we tend to forget that he was also part of and he directed one of the best mockumentaries that we've ever seen and probably will see. I'm Still Here. Remember when Joaquin Phoenix went crazy and we thought he had quit acting to pursue a rap career?
Yeah.
And it was all for a movie by Casey Affleck. So Casey Affleck was the director of that movie.
There's a lot of controversy online, even when Casey Affleck was nominated. And it's funny, you know, that all of this started coming out of the woodwork just when he got nominated. Makes you want to think about how Hollywood functions, because now there's a lot of controversy by some sections of the media and some sections of Hollywood, which is accusing him of being, you know, somewhat of a sexual deviant or probably somewhat a guy who could be a sex offender. But we are no one to judge. We can't even say anything about it because it's not been proven yet. But that's just what it is. And if you look up online, you will see that Brie Larson, who played a rape victim last year in the amazing movie Room, she did not even clap when Casey Affleck was. And there was this complete distaste in her mouth, just say, calling out his name as he won the award. So it's neither here nor there. It's just what it is. And this is something which I think I and most of the people online have noticed. I'm pretty sure you guys have noticed as well. But moving on to things which were more noticeable than Brie Larson's distaste for Casey Affleck were the actresses this year. And the nominations were Isabelle Huppert for Elle, Ruth Negga for Loving, Natalie Portman for Jackie, the obligatory Meryl Streep nomination. The winner, of course, was Emma Stone for La La Land.
Emma Stone deserved it, but I'm thankful that overrated Meryl Streep didn't win the award.
Same here. I was really afraid that she was going to win it just because of like the whole political thing. I thought there was actually a strong possibility that might happen, just people could see her name on the ballot and just vote Meryl Streep. But thankfully, that didn't happen.
Yeah, the fact that you say that we don't even know which movie she got nominated for. I have no idea. I had never even heard of this movie before the nominations were announced. And I know that none of you actually have seen the movie. I certainly haven't. So Meryl Streep has become a staple of the Oscars and other awards, and then her winning it actually is a bad thing according to me, because then she's actually getting in the way of a lot of this other actresses who probably deserve the award more than her. I mean, she has enough of those awards. We get it. You can just rest and know that you will probably be remembered as one of the greatest actresses, but it's time to let other people win awards.
I think Meryl Streep should just retire. Because I have watched Florence Foster Jenkins, the movie which she was nominated for, and this woman, she just can't put a foot wrong, you know. This was a nothing role, basically, on paper. It just was nothing. And it was just Meryl Streeping the shit out of this film. I think just cast her as Batman, cast her as Superman, cast her, like, bring her as a part of the DCAU, and that's the only hope these guys have of making a good film. Meryl Streep will drag them from the bottom of the barrel. Yeah.
Meryl Streep should be cast in the Marvel Universe, because that is the only way they can win an Oscar, because they had the best VFX this year in Doctor Strange and they did not win. So I think Marvel should be doing something about bringing Meryl Streep to the MCU.
I want to start a crowdfunding project to get Meryl Streep to play Donald Trump in a movie. It kind of looks like him, right?
But I really love the fact that she was trying to hide behind husband when Jimmy Kimmel was giving his... I absolutely love that. I mean, that was something really out of a movie. But like Arindam mentioned, I think Meryl Streep should be a part of the Marvel Universe. For me personally, as I speak about the last thing which we're going to be discussing on this edition of the Film Geeks podcast, is the Best Picture nominations. I think Marvel were hard done by, because one of the best films of this year, and not because I'm a fan, I'm just saying this just from a cinematic perspective and from the vision perspective, I think one of the best movies of this year was Captain America Civil War. And I think it was better than Hidden Figures. It was definitely better than Lion, in my opinion. And this movie deserved to be nominated. Along with Captain America Civil War, I think these movies were also better movies than Lion. And these were Arrival, Fences, Hacksaw Ridge, Hell and High Water, Hidden Figures, Manchester by the Sea, and the winner, La La Land. I'm sorry, not La La Land, the winner, Moonlight. I think there is no disputing the fact, at least for me, Moonlight was the far superior picture, and for reasons which I've said earlier.
So I don't necessarily think that La La Land is a better movie. I actually also liked Moonlight a lot. So I'm pretty fine with Moonlight winning, but I think La La Land just strikes more of a chord with me, because I was always a fan of those grand old Hollywood musicals. I think the golden age of Hollywood, so to speak, is like one of my favorite eras of film is not my most favorite era. So just right. I found this to be like a great tribute to that era, like that era, you know, like Singing in the Rain and stuff like that. Like it really evoked the classic musicals of that time. So that's why I really liked it. And plus it added its own element of sort of realism, you know, the fights that they have in between and the whole ending. So I think it just struck more of a chord with me. And of course, the performances by Ryan Gosling and Emma Stone, and just the entire look and feel and sound and song and dance of that movie, it just like blew me away. So it's just more of a film that stayed with me at that point after I watched it. Would completely agree with Abhishek's love for Moonlight as well. I thought it was like very poetic, very sensitive, just an enormously touching movie. And that's also going to stay with me for a long time. So I think I'm fine with the Moonlight winning as well.
I'm not generally a huge fan of musicals. I don't like musicals. And it's not because of the quality of the musicals that have come out in the recent times. It's just that I just can't bring myself to watch a lot of musicals. And as I've told you guys constantly with my bitching and moaning, that it took me 4 watches to watch La La Land. You know, I tried the first time I watched it, I just couldn't get past the first song. The second time I watched it for 7 minutes, the third time for 12 minutes. And finally, I sat down and watched the entire film. And I absolutely loved the film. I'm a big fan of Damien Chazelle. And I love where La La Land took me on that journey. I am a huge fan of this film now, but I can completely understand why it did not win. And the only reason why it did not win was of the reasons that we have spoken about earlier. Moonlight was a complete film in the sense that it represented a section of society which has never been represented, especially for people like us who have never seen that part of that part of urban America. Because when we think of urban America, we think of gangster rap, we think of Ice Cube knocking people out, we think of Tupac Shakur, we think of LeBron James, we think of all of these urban heroes. We never think of the guy who is growing up in a broken home, or the woman who is a drug addict but can't do anything to help herself and change her life to raise a son, or probably a kid who is dealing and trying to come to terms with his sexuality and with these things which he has no idea how to deal with, and with the lack of a father figure, and what happens to that guy when that father figure leaves or dies. You know, these are some of these things which had never been portrayed before. And I think for that reason alone, Moonlight is probably one of my favorite films of the past 5 or 6 years. This movie just blew me away.
Even bullying, I don't think we've seen bullying showed in this like anywhere in movies before. Like they showed here, it really hit home, you know, like this, the way they were portraying everything. I just totally fell in love with it, and it was much deserved. I wouldn't mind La La Land winning also, because like I said before, it reminded me a lot of Roman Holiday, which is my most favorite romantic movie. It had that ending which reminded me of that bittersweet thing, that of practical endings, as to say, and I wouldn't have minded it at all. The irony of it all, they showed us the happy ending and then they closed it off. And that is exactly what happened to them at the awards. Like, how fucking bizarre was that?
It was like some amazing 1999 Vince Russo booking, dude.
Moonlight definitely deserves to win this one. It's not because I despise musicals. It's not that. La La Land, I think, was a fantastic movie. Like Arindam, I also had to struggle getting through the first few minutes. The first song is just throws you off, you know. You start watching this movie and the song comes on and you're like, shit, what have I gotten myself into? I don't want to be watching this. And you have to push yourself through to the ending, and you understand that it totally makes sense why it's there, why it's been nominated for all these awards. It's a fantastic movie, and all the actors also have put all of their souls into it. But saying all of that, Moonlight definitely handles the much tougher topic, and it handles it in such a sensitive way that you never feel that it's about any one of those topics specifically. It's not speaking about sexuality, it's not speaking about drug abuse, it's not speaking about abandonment, parents not being there. It speaks about all of that, and it does it without having to rely on props, and which it just hits you where it hurts. It actually is a very painful movie to watch. And I'm sure you'll understand what I'm saying when I say that. It just pulls at the strings of your heart, and it makes you want to hold those people and say, you know, it's going to be all right. You know, this things suck, but it's going to be all right. And, you know, that's the reality of life. I think that's what is reflected, and that's what, you know, we kind of relate to, which is why Abhishek and I'll totally understand why you relate to it, and you say that it's one of the best movies of the past 4 or 5 years. And I'll say that, yeah, it's probably one of my favorite movies of the past 4 or 5 years as well. And so I totally think that this is definitely the movie that should have and has won the Oscars.
That brings us to the close of the show, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you so much for listening. Just a quick reminder, you can find us on Facebook at facebook.com/IndianNerve, on Twitter at twitter.com/IndianNerve, on Instagram at instagram.com/IndianNerve, and on YouTube as well at youtube.com/IndianNerve. Please hit that subscribe button that you can see in front of you. Please hit that subscribe button. It's all for free. I'd like to thank all the listeners again for all your support. And please do like, share and subscribe to this channel, and share this video among your friends. Please let us know if you would like us to talk about any of your favorite shows or films or comic books or be it whatever that you guys are interested in. If you think we'll be interested in the same thing, please let us know in the comments below, and we will definitely get to that. So from all of us here, wherever you're listening at, I hope you're having a great day, and we'll see you again next week. Bye-bye.